Okay, so again, we'd like to welcome everyone here, including our county council members who are here with us. We are missing two board members today. Chair Cindy Valancourt was not able to be here, or Ananta Hijibu. So we will be working to do our best without them today. And just a little note that we will have a hard stop of this meeting at 6 p.m. due to our public hearing on the budget that will start at 7 o'clock. So if you have a copy of agenda, you see the first issue that has been brought to us is redistricting, and I'd like to turn it over to Ms. Siggety.
On, right?
Yes.
Okay. Actually, I did not put this on the agenda. So, council members, Dr. Ball.
I asked for this on the agenda. I wanted everyone to better understand the process and timeline. As I go throughout the community, I hear lots of rumors about what's going to happen with redistricting, when it's going to start. So maybe if you could just talk about the process and timeline for the next steps moving forward.
Sure. So, welcome, everyone, to our council members, to our board members. I just want to state from the beginning that I'm extremely uncomfortable sitting in this chair. Understand that this is not my chair, and you're in my chair, Greg Fox, so if you want to be super right, I'm a lot shorter than you are. So
getting ready to lower it.
You can have that position over there momentarily. Just don't close school for snow tomorrow. Thank you. Renee Kamen, as you know, is responsible for this particular area. And all of you know we came through a redistricting process that yielded many fruitful things this past year. And Renee is prepared to go over where we see the future in terms of our projections, and I'm going to ask you to do that now.
Thank you. It's always on when I'm up here. This is unusual. No, it's okay. All right, so good afternoon, everyone who does not know me. Renee Kamen, manager of school planning. I say that with a light heart because I'm talking about redistricting. Any redistricting falls under policy 6010. The way that it's currently outlined is we're in the middle of the next process, which leads to the 18 feasibility study. In any typical year, we outline all of our projections by school, by region, and then we analyze our projections to see what types of capital improvements will be needed, whether it be temporary or permanent. And if we have the capacity, perhaps, or we know a capital improvement is coming online, and when it is, we'll start talking about the next redistricting. Having just come out of a redistricting, the next feasibility study recommendations, I don't know. We're developing them right now. But let's say, for example, if we know for certain an elementary school is coming online in a certain school year, we would start about now highlighting what a feasible redistricting would be based on certain board decisions. If you look at any one of our feasibility studies, leading up even to this past year, it probably started in 2013, 14, that says this is where our next capital improvement's going to be. It's going to open in this year, and this is the general area at staff level that we're going to have redistricting. Once we get to that year, like we just ended, starting in about the March timeframe, staff reaches out to the community, and this is under the current policy. Policies can change depending on the policy committee, and that's one set of structure over here, but for now, about the March timeframe, my office reaches out to the community and puts out a call for volunteers on the attendance area committee. The attendance area committee is a recommending body of citizens to the superintendent. So the superintendent currently and in past has used this body to come up, generate different ideas. Sometimes the folks on that board, that committee, they start from the feasibility study that's current or in the past, like the one that just ended, and build their recommendations throughout the summer. It's always open to the public. And through a variety of means, we fully get engaged citizen comments. And all of the meetings are open to the public. We report out of those meetings every week. There's a meeting minutes. From that particular standpoint, then the superintendent takes the feasibility study, takes the recommendation of the attendance area committee, and comes up with his or her own recommendation. And that generally happens in the October time period. And so this is the exact same process, unless the policy changes in the future, that would occur at the next redistricting. So when that capital improvement, whatever it be, whether it's the next high school or the elementary school, under the current capital budget, it says 2023 for the next elementary school. Typically our policy, what our policy states is a year before that capital improvement is made is when we engage in that process. So under the current capital budget, this elementary school number 43 is an example, 2023. We would start the process the year before, 2022. And so everything that I described actually happens the year before that it's implemented in the school year. And so unless the policy changes in the future, that's going to be the same track that my office takes in informing the superintendent, the board, and the public about future redistrictings.
So thank you for that very thorough description of the process. So just to be clear, given that you all are still going through your budget process and that elementary school 43 mm-hmm. is on track for 2023, mm-hmm. and I know we'll talk about it a little bit more next. High school 13 is on track for 2022.
In the current capital budget, actually, it's listed as 2024. And during this past process we had, it egged up in the line to 2022. But the current capital budget as listed that we're working under right now is set, it was set as 2024. So that's the continuing discussion that we will be having.
And what about the middle school?
There is no middle school. It's actually well out beyond the long-range mm-hmm. plan at 2030 and beyond. I think it's 2031. For the middle school, we're seeing small additions in certain places because the number of middle school students that we're seeing is spread out more and not in one particular concentrated area.
So that means that there is no intent to do any redistricting in the next year?
No. I haven't made the recommendation.
Based upon what you just said, the triggers would be the schools, and you said a year before.
Well, the triggers are outlined in the policy, and they're actually not really triggers. They're considerations for the board. So one of them would be a school emergency closing for the school. The board could consider redistricting for that. There's six factors under our policy that the board can consider. Having not written or even have, first of all, we're not completed yet with our projections. Having not even written the 2018 feasibility study, I couldn't say for certain. But that said, there are six considerations in the policy. One is an addition. One is a brand new school. Another is any kind of transportation. Like, for example, a major highway goes through a neighborhood. These are all factors that the board can consider in redistricting. And so my job is to say what those things are in the feasibility study and say that in this feasibility study, we should consider X, Y, and Z.
The reason why I'm asking is some people have indicated concern that there will be immediate redistricting starting this summer, and some think that there will never be redistricting. So I'm just trying to make sure I'm clear as far as the actual mechanics. I understand
sure.
the policy.
I will say one thing.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
May I?
Yeah.
I'm a little confused by what would be occurring in the summer. I'm not sure I understand that.
I think people don't really understand the process.
Okay, so the board was very clear and very transparent about this redistricting process. It yielded some different results. Obviously, the Jumpstart program, which is on the agenda for further discussion, what that will yield. And then the board also has left it open for further discussion for futures. They want to look at their policy. They want to look at ways to tweak it, being fresh in terms of the information that they did. They're going through their own self-evaluation. So those conversations may occur, and that's still to the leadership of the board to determine when that comes forward. But as far as any overscaled, long-range, overarching redistricting for next year, that will not be done. My job right now is to carry out the actions from the board based upon the last mass redistricting. We're in the process. And all these agendas blend together because, in fact, transportation is preparing. I mean, there's a whole series of things we have to do to get prepared for August. So the reality is it's relatively static right now as we prepare for what the board has directed us to do. And there's nothing that will shift that unless the board directs me further on that. And they have left that open for consideration to review the policy and things such as that. That may have caused some of the confusion.
May I add that the board was concerned about the process and was also concerned about some of the polygons, and there were other issues. I think it would be good if Ms. Hanks could share with the County Council the charter that the board just approved at its previous meeting. We will have three board members sit during the early part of whatever winter into the spring and bring the board recommendations on what they think needs to be our next steps on improving the process. And maybe that's part of the concern.
And will the public be part of that process?
I don't know. Right now, there's one person who has volunteered to be on the...
Actually, more. I think Ms. Hanks has some information.
Right. We have three board members that have volunteered to be on this
Great.
Redistricting committee. They're Ms. Coombs, Ms. Valancourt, and Ms. Delmont Small. And they will be like any other board committee meeting. They are public meetings. They'll be announced. They'll be held here in Boardroom A, probably. And any member of the public may attend.
Thank you.
On that score, will there be an opportunity for public input at some point?
I would imagine, yeah. Yes.
The amount of public input we receive is incredible.
Right.
And so the public is always encouraged to provide us input on any of these topics at any given time, and they surely have.
Sure.
Renee is chronicling all those, and we have that information, and we have a pretty good sense of the concern and the issues that have been raised through this redistricting process.
Right, and thinking that in terms of all the comments that you've received that you might incorporate into the review of this subcommittee, but then any recommendations for changes to that process, will that then also have opportunity for? Okay, great.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Just real quickly on that topic, I know there was a lot of discussion about the makeup and how you do the area attendance committee. Is there any thought to adjusting that? Are you going to do it the same this time? Or is that part of that same discussion?
Well, we haven't, sorry about that. We haven't discussed whether there's going to be a redistricting. So the attendance area committee is not relevant at the moment.
But
we only do that if we're going to redistrict.
I think if I understand Councilwoman Taurasi's question, is your question more towards the committee of the board and the redistricting as far as what we're going to do, or if towards redistricting, whether or not we're doing
just
it?
The area attendance committee, so if you're going to be having a discussion about process going forward.
Although we have not met, speaking as one individual board member, I would say that everything is on the table to be discussed, and I think that's an important part of the process that bears discussion.
May I add, I'm hopeful that that will occur because the feedback we've received from the community, the challenges regarding representation, diversity in both economic and racial, making certain that all factions of the community were represented. And again, the challenges that presents is because of the we need to do a better job in terms of individual outreach, and that was very clearly conveyed to me from the board.
Kathy? I've pulled up the charter. It might help you with the discussion, but the goal of the redistricting committee is to provide continuous improvement recommendations to the full board on the redistricting process, and their objectives is to review the current redistricting process defined under policy 6010 school attendance areas, review the polygon creation process, identify implementation timelines of committee recommendations, and review recommendations with legal counsel prior to the board presentation. So I hope that helps you.
Okay, Dr. Ball, is your question?
Yeah, I'm good. And I guess my question is, as it relates to your guys' testimony recently on APFO, as far as the 100% and everything, as far as for the being the optimum limit, how will that play into your policy 6010 in your decisions as you redistrict? And, you know, will that become your guidance as well as far as when you're redistricting to then limit to the extent you're able to based off of, you know, general areas, if there's a region or adjacent schools that they would all then be, if that area was all under 100%, that every school would be, because that would be your goal, or would you that not be your policy?
At this time, we have not discussed that in depth, and so I think we would have to wait until we till the board has had an opportunity to look at it as we go forward, as we consider capacity in our schools.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, we will certainly take a look in advance of reaching the 100%. Once it reaches 90%, we will be looking at where the future lies for that school in that area, and think well ahead as to some options for either expanding a school or the need to build a new school.
Now, I guess my question is, as it relates to those that are already over 100%, and where you have neighboring schools that are that may be adjacent schools that are less than 100%, and together they're less than 100, right. What would your plans be at that point, based off of your testimony that you provided to the council?
I think we would have to look very closely at any school that is at 100% or close to 100% right now. I would imagine that the committee will take a very close look at those areas, see if we can make accommodations or whether we need to build or expand the schools that we have at that time. I mean, we're going to have to take a look case by case of each of those areas that look like they're approaching or at capacity and see what needs to be done. But we don't have any plans in place at the moment.
So Ms. Elwerger, I'm not talking about this, things are changing. Things are, let's say it's a static thing. You know, you're looking out over time and your two neighboring schools, one's at, unfortunately, I thought I had my past, you're lucky I don't today, don't have all my June reports with me. But, it, you know, where you have a neighboring, one school at, I don't know, 108 and a school next to it at 88. So actually they're averaging down, under 100, and you're there, and you're making that decision to continue to keep them that way. But based off of what your guidance was to us, I'm just trying to understand, would you, during that process, be under your plans now, going forward, then redistrict those two down? Even though they're potentially between your 90 and 110, or about 88, but below it, but I'm just asking if your policy would be potentially changing based off of the guidance that you had provided to the council.
Anyone want to take a shot at that?
Ms. Coombs? Or?
When the feasibility study comes out, it's up to us whether or not we determine to do another redistricting. So the feasibility study is presented every year. So we could next year do that.
Mr. Fox, would you like me to try and
ask the last time?
Okay. I think part of the question is looking at your policy 6010 in the 90 to 110% range. In this review, are you considering adjusting when you might redistrict to be different, or adjust your policy to be reflective of?
I think that's what the committee is going to considering, right, whether there needs to be any changes to the current policy, okay, or whether we keep it as is. We don't have a decision on that,
sure,
at this, no,
I just,
at this time.
I think we're trying to figure out if that was part of your consideration, and that at the end product may be a new policy and what that might entail. So, great. Did that come closer? Okay. Thank you.